Great morning, residents and citizens of Bunnell. On Thursday evening, we had a community meeting to discuss the state of our utilities here in the city of Bunnell. In April, the board adopted a master utility plan, and the intent of that master utility plan was to identify all the deficiencies within our utility system. That plan was completed, and it has identified all the deficiencies as well as come up with the prioritized set of projects over the next 10 years that we need to address. This morning, what we want to do is I have the infrastructure director, Dustin Boss, and the finance director, Shana Stankiewicz, here this morning to discuss the state of our utilities, what it's going to cost to eliminate those deficiencies, and basically how it's going to impact you, the residents, in increasing of utility fees. So we're asking you to please listen. If you have any questions after this presentation, please don't hesitate to call me. My number is 986-6004. That's 386-986-6004. Alvin Jackson, the city manager for the city of Bunnell. Thank you. Dustin.
Hello and good afternoon, everybody. My name is Dustin Vose, infrastructure director for the city of Bunnell. Moving forward, the city has prepared a master utility plan. CPH engineers performed the water portion of the master plan, and Kimley Horn performed the wastewater, fiber optic, and stormwater master plans, as well as a community engagement portion. The master plans were adopted by the board March 9th, 2020. The master plan provides a strategic plan of immediate repairs and future repairs in the infrastructure system. Having a formalized master plan prioritizes the city in the funding application review process. So I really want to say hats off to the board and our city manager for allowing us to complete a master utility plan to really outline the issues we face within the utility system in the city of Bunnell. Trying to get to the next slide, sorry. Okay, so here are the few projects listed on the master plan. As you can see, there are quite a few just within the inner city. We have Grand Reserve up here. There's a few projects out at the end of the road. Excuse me. And there is the amount of work that needs to be done within our utility system. Next slide. So right here is a brief description, animation, illustration of how a sewer system works in most municipalities, including the city of Bunnell. I'm going over this because sewer wastewater tends to fall under the flush it and forget it mentality. It leaves a house. We have no idea what it takes to actually treat that water into reusable water for our residents and our community. So right here at the pointer you have at the house, you typically have a clean out at the house side and another clean out over here on the city side, which allows a snake, an eel, anything, a Roto-Rooter to get in the line from your house to the main sewer main on the street for cleaning. Then you have your sewer main, gravity sewer main, that runs all the way down the street, higher at this end, lower at this end, so the water flows. And it keeps going and keeps going and keeps going downhill. Obviously, in the city of Bunnell, we don't have hills like this. This is just an illustration to show that gravity flow moves the water. At a certain point, it gets too deep to where you physically can't dig that deep in the state of Florida because of the aquifers and the underground water. where it reaches a pump station, where pumps actually lift it back up. A lift station lifts it back up, or a pump station just pumps it. Basically the same thing. Over to another higher manhole to continue the walk down to the wastewater treatment plant, or into a force main directly to the wastewater treatment plant. And there is a wastewater treatment plant. So speaking of the wastewater treatment plant, here is an overview of the city's wastewater treatment facility. Flow from the entire city, and when I mention the term flow, I'm talking about raw wastewater, sewage coming from gravity and force mains to the wastewater treatment plant, enters the plant right here. If you see the little pointer, that is the master lift station. From the lift station, it gets pumped to this tank right here. It goes through screenings where we screen out the rags and debris. Approximately 100 pounds of rags a day come through our system that we're actually screening out before it actually enters into the wastewater plant. Into the flow equalization tank here, which it just equalizes the flow so we can maintain a consistent flow rate through the plant. It gets pumped from there to the oxidation ditch where the initial treatment takes place. At this oxidation basin, oxidation ditch, is the home of, you can't even count how many microorganisms, billions and trillions and quadrillions of microorganisms that actually eat and process the raw wastewater. From there, it comes to these two tanks here, which are clarifiers, which settle out the sludge and gets the clean water off top. The clean water runs through the filter system, the sand filters, into the chlorine contact chamber right here, where chlorine is added and proper disinfection is achieved, over to the post-aeration basin. Now, during low flow, normal flow events, we continue to stay in reclaimed water, which then gets pumped by these pumps here to the reclaimed ground storage tank over here, and then these pumps pump it to Grand Reserve Golf Course and Austin Outdoors Nursery. During times of high flow or less quality water, it is bypassed from reclaim use to creek discharge, which is an underground pipe that comes from here out to the drainage canal. Trying to get to the next slide. So this tank right here is the original plant from 1972. Concrete tank, it's still in use as the digester, the sludge holding digester. In 1972, the population was 1,409, and this plant served it. Now around 1992, these two plants, steel ring plants, were installed because the population increased to 2,124, and more size and better treatment was required. Excuse me. In 2003 through 2004, upgrades, the oxidation ditch here and the reclaimed storage tank here, were installed to provide better treatment to obtain reclaimed quality water for the golf course and Austin Outdoors Nursery. And currently in 2019, our population grew to 3,271. Before I go to the next slide, I just want to comment really quick on the condition of each tank. This is the original tank from 1972. It's a concrete tank. It is in fair condition from 1972. It is actually, one would say, good condition for the age of it. The FE tank was online with the 1992 with these tanks. That's a steel tank. It's in decent condition. However, these two clarifier BTU units are in poor condition and immediate need of repair. The steel-framed sand filters are in poor condition and need immediate repair. The chlorine contact basin chamber is undersized for the flows the plant is currently seeing, and it becomes difficult to maintain proper disinfection. The oxidation ditch from 2003 is in perfect, let me rephrase that, in good condition. This tank will still continue to be used with the new treatment plant. So here you see the projected flows for the wastewater treatment plant. 2018, we were already close. The green line is our permitted capacity of 600,000 gallons a day. 2018, we were already close to that. 2019, we've gotten closer. 2020, we're going to be at the cusp of it. 2021, we're already going to be at our permitted capacity, running 80 to 90% capacity. 2022, we will be going over it. 2023, we have exceeded our capacity. The purple line is peak flows. That is rainstorm events, which we're going to get into on the next slide with inflow and infiltration. But as you can see, we do not have much time for the capacity of our wastewater treatment plant. So inflow and infiltration, commonly known as I&I in the wastewater world, is just that, the inflow of surface rainwater and through manholes without manholes not being properly sealed with manhole rings or lids. Other areas, lift stations built too far down underground, and then cracks in the actual sewer system, allowing groundwater and stormwater just to pour in. And this exists throughout the city. The collection system issues, first and foremost, manholes. There are 325 total, and the majority of them need replacement or structural lining. So if we look here, this was an actual manhole on the side of State Road 100. You can see the deterioration of the concrete. When these manholes were installed in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, the number one coating that they used was a basic tar coating, which does not stand up to hydrogen sulfide. Hydrogen sulfide is a very common number one gas in the collection system in sewer treatment, and it is very corrosive and needs the concrete. This manhole here actually had concrete fall and clog the inlets, not allowing flow, and also backed up into a residential property. An emergency repair was done down here. Structural lining with a 70-year life was installed, and this needs to be done to the majority of the manholes in the city. So with the gravity sewer lines, 87,700 linear feet, 80% of those gravity lines are vitrified clay pipe, like terracotta pots. If anyone owns a terracotta pot, you know, you water it and you see the water seep on the outside. So it allows water in. You can see here on this photo, we have a crack in the gravity line where roots have grown in and calcium buildup has built up on it. The city has made great strides in obtaining grants for slip lining, cure-in-place plastic liner, which is this photo right here. This has actually been done to one of our sewer gravity mains in the city. It's a plastic liner that's also structural and seals up the pipe so you do not get roots and water infiltrating in. This project we have done has really helped with the storm flows at the wastewater treatment plant. We have 70,000 linear feet of force mains. Force mains, again, are gravity main, or not gravity main, sewer mains that have a pump pumping the sewage through it. And upsizing, there's a lot of upsizing in the master plan scheduled, and I just want to comment that upsizing is growth dependent of the force mains. Now we have 17 city-owned lift stations. Ongoing repairs needed for lift stations is continuous pump replacements. If you think about the environment that these pumps are working in, it is extremely corrosive, hostile, just not a fun environment. Pumping sand continuously, rags, debris, they wear out. Panel replacement is another ongoing repair because the panels are in the weather continuously. And sometimes lift stations are in need of complete rehabilitation. As you can see in this photo up here, the concrete around this lift station is starting to look like the concrete that was in the manhole in the previous slide. The bottom slide shows a lift station that we actually had sandblasted and coated with the same structural 70-year liner that will extend the life of the actual underground tank itself for about 70 years. So with the collection system, we've had recent rehabilitation projects. I talked about the slip lining efforts that we have been doing. With the West Side Project, we lined 4,900 linear feet of gravity sewer main that was funded through a ready grant with St. John's River Water Management District. The next one was the Southside CIPP lining project, where we lined 7,200 linear feet. We also lined laterals and installed cleanouts on the city side where cleanouts were not present. That was a CDBG grant for $700,000. And we've actually just completed the Northside CIPP lining project, which lined 17,000 linear feet. That was a ready grant from St. John's River Water Management District for $500,000. A part of the Southside CIPP lining project was the rehabilitation of the North Anderson lift station. We replaced the pumps, electrical systems were upgraded, driveway constructed, perimeter fencing installed, and the lining of the tank. By performing the work in-house, we saved $35,223 on that project. So now we get to the water portion of the master plan, and I understand the number one comment out there is, but we just got a brand new water plant. How could we need any more updates? Well, we got a brand new water treatment facility, ion exchange. We got a brand new ground storage tank. We got a brand new aerator. We did not get a brand new high service pump or any raw water wells, nor did we perform any maintenance on the actual distribution system itself. So speaking of raw water wells, we have five total wells. Three of them are in use, and two of them are in need of repair or rehabilitation. Water mains, we have 197,570 linear feet, consisting of 3/4 inch to 12 inch pipe diameter. Part of the master plan is upsizing water mains that are under 6 inches to 6 inch. So we can provide proper flow, proper pressure, proper water age, and proper fire protection to our residents. There are pressure issues throughout the city of Bunnell, so we are in need of new high service pumps, additional high service pumps, and upsizing of the high service pumps. This is a photo of nice new high service pumps that is built into the master plan that we will be funding shortly. We're also in need of a booster pump station and a 200,000 gallon ground storage tank on the north side of the city on US-1 to provide increased pressures to Otis Stone, Hunter, and Steel Rail, as well as portions of Grand Reserve. Recent rehabilitation projects on the distribution system, Well 7, and the water system altogether. Well 7 was just rehabilitated for $26,975. This is actual Well 7 getting flush and it's cleaning. Clear Well Transfer Pump, which was new with the water treatment plant, was in need of full rehabilitation, which cost $8,700. And a 10-inch water main from Grand Reserve direct to the water treatment plant has just been completed installation. It's passed its pressure testing. This is the actual pipe going in the ground at the water plant. And it is scheduled next week for bacterial sampling and will be pushed online once it passes the testing. This line was installed by D.R. Horton in order to not increase pressure in Grand Reserve, but to maintain pressure in Grand Reserve during periods of high usage. And well number 4 rehabilitation is scheduled for August 2020 this year. So speaking about all the projects that we have, here's our 10-year capital improvement plan. We're going to look at the pie right here. Mr. Pac-Man, $24.1 million is the wastewater master plan projects. The little brown portion here, 1.3 million is the water plant or water master plan projects, and the 6 million is the city capital portion. This amount, total projects city portion, $31.4 million is the amount of money to complete all of the projects in the master plan that the city will have to come up with. $7.2 million for the wastewater treatment plant, $10.6 million for the collections system improvement, 6.3 for reclaimed water improvements. Pipe upsizing, 300,000 for the water plant. Main looping, 100,000 wells, 200,000. All other in the water master plan, $700,000. This does not include all of the grants the city has already obtained. And before I hand it over to Shanna, our finance director, I do want to mention that with all of these numbers, the city has only included grants and funding opportunities that we 100% know that we can obtain. We will continue searching for grants throughout the system, but we cannot base our financial needs on what ifs. We can only go by actual factual grants that we can obtain. With that being said, I'll pass it over to Shanna Stankiewicz, our finance director.
Thank you, Dustin. So as mentioned, part of the master plan was not only to come up with a capital improvement plan over the next 10 years, but it also was to come up with a funding plan for the next 10 years. So Stantec is a financial company that was contracted as part of the master plan. And so I just wanted to kind of go over some of their findings with you today. So first question is, how do we fund the utility system? So you'll see on this slide that the utility system is funded by users in the form of a monthly utility bill. So I'm sure you recognize this is a portion of a bill. Every month you get this, shows you how much water you used for the month, and then you have your totals in the red box there, and you can see that what you're charged for water, what you're charged for sewer, and what you're charged for garbage. One thing to point out is that garbage, of course, relates to the solid waste fund. It has nothing to do with water and sewer. So therefore, in all the rates that we're discussing today, none of that will impact the portion of your bill that's related to garbage, only the portion that's related to water and sewer. So if you go to the next slide, one question that we get often is, but what about the property taxes I pay? So one thing that people don't always realize is that your taxes can actually only go to fund governmental services, not your utilities. And that's why you get a separate bill for your utilities, because those are paid with user fees, not by taxes. So if you look here, there's a sample tax bill. This is a tax bill from a homeowner who lives in Grand Reserve. You can see all of the different jurisdictions that tax the property. There's Flagler County, there's the school board, St. John's River Water Management, mosquito control, and so forth. And this total tax bill, you can see at the very bottom, is a little over $4,500 for the year. The portion that is highlighted is the piece of the bill that's levied by your City of Bunnell commissioners, and the portion that we receive here in the city to provide you governmental services. And you can see on this tax bill, that's $715 out of the $4,500. So that's about 15% of the tax bill that we receive in the city. And then looking to the right, you can see what we do with that $715. So we provide you with a city commission, we have city manager and clerk's office, we have finance, human resources, legal, IT, we provide the facilities, public buildings, we provide a police department, public works, which primarily takes care of the roads within the city, a community development department, which handles permitting and all the new growth, code enforcement, and also provide parks and recreation services. And again, at the bottom, none of your tax dollars are allocated to water and sewer or solid waste. So Stantec had to come up with a plan, you know, how can we fund the $31 million that's needed for the capital projects over the next 10 years. So if you go to the next slide, we had to start with analyzing, well, who are our users? What type of customers do we have? What quantity of water and sewer are they using per month? So here you can see the breakdown where water is on the left, sewer is on the right. Primarily, the customers that we have are residential customers. You can see there's almost 1,300 residential customers, whereas there's around 500 commercial customers. and you can see their usage. So all of this is important in gathering the data so that then we can then determine what rates are needed. So if you go to the next slide. This is going to show you graphs of what the outcome was using those customers. We also included growth assumptions of approximately 100 new accounts per year, which is what's been happening over the last couple years since Grand Reserve has been online. And that falls in line with what Grand Reserve's growth plan is over the next 10 years. So if we don't change our rates, you can see on the left-hand side here where the pointer is, that black line is what revenue we would earn each year. Would not changing our rates, just adding approximately 100 new customers per year. But what's happening is all the colors in the background, the darker blue, the lighter blue, and the purple, those are all of the expenses in the system. So the darker blue on the bottom is your operations and maintenance. The lighter blue is part of the $31 million that would be funded with cash by the city. And then the purple part is existing and future debt that would need to be taken out in order to fund the $31 million in projects. You can clearly see there's not enough revenue coming in to cover your costs. So ultimately what that means is to the chart on the right is if we have $2.8 million in the bank currently, and if for each year you're spending more than is coming in, you can see the fund balance decreases next year. And then in 2022, essentially, the utility is bankrupt. You have negative cash. And clearly, this is not a workable option. So if you go to the next slide, this is what Stantec has come up with as a recommended rate plan. The top part shows you exactly the same thing that was in the graph, but it's just put here in numbers where you can see what our revenue requirements would be versus what our revenues would be with a recommended rate plan. So the line where the cursor is, that's the recommended rate plan. It is a 12% increase each year over the first 3 years. But then after that, we could just have a 3% inflationary increase annually just to keep up with the cost of living and the way that prices increase just to operate the system. With this plan, you can see even in the first 2 years, we still have to dip into those reserves. We're still going to decrease our fund balance. But by the third year, we can start breaking even and be able to support the operations and the capital and still have some funding in the bank and planning for the future. So the bottom line is the really, really important line, and that's what the debt service coverage is. So just like you, when you go out to borrow money, perhaps for a mortgage, they want to make sure that you have income that you're going to be able to pay all of your other bills and also pay your monthly mortgage payment. So same type of thing for the city. We think it's the best if the city finances a large portion of the $31 million needed in capital projects, because that will help lower the amount of cash that we need on the front end, but it will also spread those costs over the next 30 to 40 years when there's new users coming into the system so that they can also help pay for the cost of the system versus putting the burden on only the 3,000 current residents. So in order to get those loans, we have to make sure that that debt service coverage is at least a 1.2 ratio. If it's below that, then it's very possible that no one is going to loan us the money that we need to be able to fund the projects. So if you go to the next slide, this is the same chart that you saw earlier, but this has the recommended rate plan that we just discussed. So now you could see on the left that while we're still not going to have more cash coming in than expenditures in the first 3 to 4 years, we do eventually start to break even through years 24, 25, and up to 26. Then we have enough cash coming in that we can start building back up our reserves and planning for those future periods beyond these 10 years. And so to the right, you can see what happens. The money that you had in the bank is still going to decrease over the next few years, but it will then stabilize and then start to build. So if you go to the next slide, ultimately, the result based on the plan as being proposed accomplishes these items. We do get to a point, not immediately, but we do get to a point where cash in becomes greater than cash out. We are able to maintain that debt service coverage of 1.2, which is critical so that we can get those loans, so that we could spread costs out over the life of those capital projects. We are able to maintain a target reserve. We are able to fund the $31 million that we need. And we are, after the first 3 years, able to get to a level rate adjustment plan so that citizens can plan for just a moderate inflationary increase instead of having bills that have peaks and valleys where we have to have discussions about large increases. And that's what we want to prevent for the future. We go next slide.
All right, thank you, Shana. And since this is a public education presentation, I did want to throw in here emergency after hours contact information. Should any member of the public see a red light or hear an alarm going off at a lift station, please call the phone number at the bottom. If you are a resident that has a PEP alarm, please call the number at the bottom. If you happen to see or experience a sewage backup or a leak anywhere in the city, please call that number, 386-255-6670, any time of day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, doesn't matter if it's Christmas. Our job and our responsibility and our duty is to protect our residents and provide the best services possible. If you see a sewage leak, give us a call. On the water side, if your water is not working, please call that number. If you have low water pressure, please call the number. Water leaks, also please call the number any time of day. Thank you very much. And that is the end of the slideshow.
We just want to thank Dustin and Shana for the presentation. And I trust that this really is an education on our utility system, in particular our sewage system. And we're asking residents, if you have any questions, please don't hesitate to go to our website. You can find my phone number on the website, the city manager, that's 386-986-6004. Also on the website, you will see the phone numbers for both Dustin and Shana. So once again, thank you for listening to our utility information spot today. Have a great day. Thank you.